Today's episode of the Multiversity Coffee Break is brought to you by Comixology. Immerse yourself in more than 20,000 digital comic books, graphic novels, and manga titles from over 125 publishers with Comixology. Our first-in-class guided view technology provides an unparalleled immersive and cinematic reading experience for readers. Purchase a la carte titles or start a monthly Comixology Unlimited account to save 15% on select publishers. Still not sold? Try an unlimited subscription free for 30 days and see why thousands of readers trust Comixology for both classic and new releases from DC, Image, Marvel, and more. Thanks.
Do you want to talk about comic books?
Let's talk about comic books, yes. So for folks who are tuning in live on Twitch, welcome to the Multiversity Coffee Break. I do have my coffee right here.
I have my coffee as well. It's Donald Duck this morning.
Oh, you're going with Donald Duck. Okay, this is my daughter made this for me. She painted it and like fired it in a kiln. So this is one of my many coffee cups. So yeah, when Josh and I started texting last night, because he's a good friend and someone I needed to delay a week, and he was like, "Yeah, I'll do it," which is awesome.
You got me at like the exact right time. This is how we can segue into some stuff if you want to just talk about things. You got me at the exact right time where I turned in like two things yesterday. And so it was like I turned them in. We're working on death metal stuff. You know, Flash is in the past. Like, I finished working on it a long time ago, and it went to print a few weeks ago. And so my last issue's come out in 2 weeks. So I was in this moment where I was, like, looking at my to-do list, and I'm like, oh, man, I literally have only a couple lettering drafts today that I need to work on and some, like, notes, but nothing is, like, hardcore due today. I have a couple meetings to talk about death metal. But that was why when you texted, I was like, yes, yes, I can do this. Because it was, like, right after I turned those things in that I was like, yeah, I can actually make that work. All right, let's do that. Let's hang out. Let's
talk. I do appreciate it very, very much so.
And go ahead, you're doing your spiel. I'm sorry.
No, that's right. And no, I was gonna say, you know, your run on the Flash is ending in just a few weeks now, 2 weeks.
2 weeks from today or yesterday, whatever.
Yeah, that's. Yeah. And I have to tell you, and you know, you and I are like legitimate friends, so that, you know, I'm not blowing smoke. I wouldn't say this if I didn't mean it. You wrote my favorite line of dialogue of 2020 so far.
What was it?
You have to guess. It's a Flash line.
Oh my god! I don't know. Was it? Oh man, I don't even know. I couldn't even guess. There's so many.
We are the Flash.
Oh, we are the Flash.
Yeah.
Dude, let me tell you something about that. I did not. So I have to confess something here. So after we had my daughter, I started watching less and less television. So I am so far behind on the Flash. Like, unless somebody asks me specifically to watch the show, or if they're like, hey, this episode, or I'll be honest, if I see like Gorilla Grodd or something, like I'll watch an episode. I'm like, I'll watch. You got Gorilla Grodd on TV? I'll watch that. I'll figure it out. I'll make effort to watch that one. Or if it's something with like Godspeed or, you know, one of like the characters I create, I'll watch it. But you know, I barely have time at night to do anything.
I get it, man.
You know, with the kids and stuff, and with the baby, like I was talking to Riley Rossmo about this yesterday, who was asking about all these TV shows, and I was like, dude, what are you talking about? What TV shows? Like, I'm lucky if I watch like a half hour or something at night. So that all being said, I had no idea they had that in the TV show, the Weird of the Flash.
They did? Show.
Yeah, but I guess it was something. I guess it was like Iris says it. And like the memes I've seen of it definitely made it feel like a smaller statement. No knock on the show, but it was really weird because I always thought like that's the thing, right? Like when you look at Green Lanterns, nobody has a problem with the idea that there are just like this huge core of Green Lanterns and they're all called Green Lanterns.
Right.
And you know, there's Hal Jordan and Guy and John and Kyle and, you know, whichever one's your favorites. With the Flashes, there always seems to be this debate over like one or the other, right? But to me, the Flash family is the Flash, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, it's all of these characters together. That's what makes up the Flash too. It isn't just Barry. And that was the thing that Barry was trying to say to Thawne in that moment, because Thawne is so, obviously Thawne is so petty and manipulative and so, you know, he doesn't understand it. Like, he doesn't understand the Flash, even though he considers himself an expert. You know, he is the curator of the museum in the future. He considers himself this huge expert of the Flash. He still doesn't get it. He doesn't understand it. And that's what Barry was saying to him in that moment, is like, you don't get it, dude. Like, there isn't just one of me. Being the Flash is not Barry Allen. And that's why in that moment he says, we are the Flash. I had no idea that that was like the whole thing. And so people were asking about it. And I was like, this is what I believe. I can't speak to anything else. I believe the Flash family is the Flash, and it's them together, and that's what I was trying to do in that moment.
That actually ties into what I wanted to talk to you about today a little bit. So
yeah, go ahead.
I think part of that is because we're relatively close in age, I think. How old are you?
39.
I'm 38, so yeah. So we're
okay. I'm still in my 30s, man. We're hanging on.
Like that cat in that poster, just hang in there. That's also their 30s right now. But but I feel like we grew up in a time when there were more speedsters in the Flash comic. It wasn't just a Barry comic. It was Wally and it was Max and it was Impulse. And so I think for us, that's always been a thing, because in the 90s, DC in the 90s, I think, is one of the most fascinating times in comics. I know that. When you think about 90s comics, I think Image rightly gets a huge spotlight shown on them. In the early 90s, Marvel, you know, with the Jim Lee X-Men stuff, like, you know, that's a huge period of time too. But to me, DC in the 90s is this experiment in legacy and
putting
characters forward. And I find it to be like the most fascinating time of comics to revisit. I've been rereading a lot of it lately. So I guess I just want to start, what are some of your favorite 90s comics in general?
I really like JLA and Grant Morrison. That's from, Howard Porter, that's from 97. Obviously Flash, you know, it's like the Mark Waid Flash stuff, which basically is the majority of the 90s. You know, he was writing it. You know, there's a couple little blips here and there where he doesn't, you know, where Grant and Mark Millar come in. But those were good. It's funny, like, I have these shelves in my office, right? Like, and over here, there's a whole bookshelf that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 shelves tall, and it's just Batman trades over here on this wall over here. It's like every Batman trade ever released. And then I have all this DC stuff right here. And yes, there's a lot of stuff in here that are modern things from the 2000s, but a lot of stuff, there's definitely a lot of 90s stuff. Like, one of the things I loved in the 90s, so it's interesting when people talk about the 90s in comics, I think a lot of times what they end up talking about is like 90 to 93, maybe 94.
Yep.
Right? Like, they're talking a lot about Image, beginning of Image. They talk a lot about Death of Superman or Nightfall.
Mm-hmm.
They're all in that window, but obviously there's a huge thing after that, right? Like Preacher. Like, Preacher's a great book. That's in the 90s. Hunter Bullets started later. I think it started in like 2000, 2001. But it's like, I think, might be wrong. I'm trying to remember. But Starman. So here's the thing about DC in the 90s, and I'm not sure what the public like thoughts on this event were, but, you know, I was going to the comic book store every week, like riding my bike to get comics post like 92. Like, oh, I was already buying books before that. But when you get to around 82, I was always going to the shop and buying my own books. One thing that really got me into DC stuff particularly was Zero Hour. Like, when Zero Hour hits, they put all those Zero issues, right? And all those Zero issues are like, here is kind of an introduction to this character. And in some ways it was completely different, right? Like, you had obviously a new Starman, right? Like, Starman is a 90s DC book that is awesome.
My favorite comic of all time.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that. Yeah, I love it, dude. I was just thinking about it yesterday about how it's interesting how much of a happy ending that book has. Like, there aren't really many books that have that, not just a happy ending, but got left alone afterward.
Yeah,
you know, like, a lot of books and a lot of characters, it's so rare for a series to have that, where a character in some ways was retired after that. Like, there hasn't been a Starman book since. The only Starman book you could say is they did what, like a Blackest Night issue.
Yep.
That continued afterward.
There was a Shade maxi series that had some connections, but it wasn't really a Starman story.
No, and obviously Stargirl. Like, I mean, Stargirl obviously is like connected into it. And
right, but it's not a Jack Knight story.
It's not a Jack Knight story, and that's what's fascinating, is like, we haven't really seen Jack Knight. You know, like, he literally drives off into the sunset on the last page. Like, he leaves Opal City to go to San Francisco, right? So it's like, That's the end for that character. But yeah, so Zero Hour presented all of these books. Zero Hour, like, DC was really interesting about taking these kind of, like, these gambles, where you look at something like Bloodlines, and I really liked Bloodlines when I was a kid. I think this is one of the things about, like, I'm the one. It's me, and it's Steve Orlando.
Like, that doesn't surprise me at all. Knowing Steve,
it's just the two of us. Well, Steve actually used one of the characters from Bloodlines in his JLA run. You know, but so, you know, when you look at like Bloodlines, they did this experiment where they introduced the, you know, the line of annuals with all of these new characters, and they got Hitman out of that, right? Like, Hitman is, I think, one of my favorite books. Like, it's definitely in the top 10. I did a reread of it maybe like 2 years ago. And I was like, man, this is so good. It ends so abruptly, though. Like, you forget. It's funny, like, in my memory, when I'm reading before, I remember being much more of a, like, triumphant ending. I remember how it ended, but I remember it being much more of a build-up to that ending. And when I read the second time around, I still really loved it, but it definitely was like, oh, yeah, that happened so abruptly. Like, it happened so quick. It's a great ending, but it happened so quick. Peter Tomasi was actually the editor on Hitman. And one year we were stuck in a car together driving to a convention from like the hotel or whatever, and we started talking about how great that book was and how it had such a great story engine built into it. You know, it was like Tommy would get a job. Like, it was just an easy book to for like Garth Ennis to do, because it was just like, what's this arc gonna be about? Okay, well, Tommy gets a job. Like, you could just pick up whatever you wanted and whatever crazy thing and just run with it, because Tommy would get a job. And then eventually start getting into Tommy's mythology with his family and stuff. But before that, it's just that. So what else, man? What else is some great stuff?
It's funny. I actually think a book that they're totally different books, but I think in terms of the structure is similar, is actually the just now wrapping up Rob Venditti Hawkman book.
Because it's great.
He's telling the different stories of the different lives that he's lived. And so it's kind of a similar thing. If he's lived these thousands of lives, just pick a time or a place and tell that story, right? And so I think that that's a similar structure, similar engine.
Yeah, I like that book a lot. I read the newest issue last night, and I think it's great. I mean, I think that what Rob has built with Hawkman, like, is such a cool mythology, and be able to bring all those characters and tie everything together the way he has, on top of just telling cool Hawkman stories.
Right, yeah.
Like, he took on such a big task. Hawkman can be, I don't think Hawkman is a tough character to write, but there is so much mythology there. You know, there's so much to kind of tie up into it, and I think he was able to do that while telling just a cool story. Another DC thing, this is kind of, now I'm going to talk about Marvel for a second with this, of things I really liked. So there were four books all written by the same writer, and I think this is when I started realizing, it's weird when you're a kid, like, you recognize writers write these books, and you recognize artists do these books. Like, I started to figure it out when I was, like, third or fourth grade of, like, oh, this person does this job.
Right.
You know, and you start, like, recognizing the names. And so it's, like, Mark Waid was a name that I started recognizing early. You know, it was, like, Flash, and then Kingdom Come, which is also 90s. And then looking at other stuff Mark Waid was doing, which we'll get into that in a second, because there's other Zero Hour books we can talk about. But Peter David did four books at the same time that I was like obsessed with. And it was Spider-Man 2099, X-Factor, Hulk, and then Aquaman. And he did all four of those books at the same time, which is crazy, because those are like big runs that were like, you can kind of pinpoint those runs on all those things. So obviously X-Factor, it's funny, he doesn't start writing X-Factor until, like, issue, what, like, 72, I think?
It's pretty far.
77? No, it's 70. It's, like, 71 or something, right? But he writes it, like, much later in it. But then he, like, almost for a long time took ownership of that name of X-Factor. Mm-hmm. It's like, if there was an X-Factor book, you almost expected Peter David. I know Leah Williams is doing it right now, and it's great. But there was, like, a time where it was, like, his
that
thing.
That was his thing, yeah.
Yeah, it was his thing. Is it with Aquaman? You know, like Aquaman, you know, missing the hand, having the harpoon hand, and having long hair. Like, that whole thing that we really identify with Hawkman, like our generation. One time I was in the DC offices, and I was just like walking the halls. And so at DC, they have this wall of like maybe 3 months worth of covers.
Mm-hmm.
So they're just kind of like, this is, you know, like each title, each character, and then it'll have like, you know, whatever the current cover is, whatever's the next month and the month after that. So sometimes it's fun, you'll be in the office and you'll walk past it and you get to see like 2 months out of covers. And sometimes you'll see stuff you haven't seen before, right? Because it's not your book, you know, or not your group. And so you look over and you're like, oh man, that's awesome. And I remember I was walking and Chris Conroy, he was putting the covers up, and it was Aquaman 25, which was during like the Rebirth era.
Yes.
It was Aquaman 25, and that was the first time Aquaman had a beard and long hair again.
It was the Rebirth.
Yeah, it was the Unsedgic, yes. And I literally was like, is this real? Like, stopped in the middle of the hall and was like, is this a real cover? Is this really happening? And Conroy was like, yes, that's happening. I think he was editor at the time. And I straight out hugged him in the middle of the hallway. So I was like, finally. And that was before, you know, you're talking about that's in 2017. And I don't know if there had been, I mean, I guess we knew because of the movie stuff that Aquaman had like long hair and a beard in the movie, but there was never really like a conversation about making him look like that in the comics at that time, at least that I wasn't a part of.
Right.
But the moment I saw that, I was, hell yeah, dude, like, let's do that. Let's do that. That's great. Like, it's such a cool thing. But Peter David's Aquaman, to me, is like, I don't know. I don't want to say it's my favorite Aquaman, but it's the Aquaman that I really, like, came in on, because you have that. You have Time and Tide before that that he did, and the Peter David did. And then Eric Battle, who like disappeared off the face of the planet after doing that Aquaman run, he just like stopped. am I getting it wrong? Not Eric Battle, what's that guy's name? Anyway, yeah, so it was like that, but then you had Spider-Man 2099 with Peter David, Rick Leonardi, which is awesome.
Love it.
Such a good book. It's crazy, it's like underrated. A lot of those 2099 books are very underrated, I think.
I think it was so easy to dismiss the gimmick of it that nobody actually read the books.
Yeah. I never read Ravager. I can admit it. I never read Ravager. For whatever reason, it never... The rumor I ever always heard about Ravager was it was supposed to be Stan and Ditko. That was, like, the original pitch.
Oh.
And, of course, that was, like, never going to happen. But that's what I, like, heard was the original pitch, was it was going to be Stanley and Ditko doing it. And then, yeah, that didn't happen. But this Punisher 2099 one, I really liked. Doom, I always kind of felt back and forth on the Doom one. But it was interesting to see sort of the evolution of those books. And then, like, X-Men 2099. Mm-hmm. I do remember being disappointed when Fantastic Four 2099 started, and it was just the Fantastic Four.
Yep.
It wasn't like this is some crazy version of it. And then what else? Then Hulk. It is interesting, like, maybe you can attest to this, and we can talk about this. Have you ever had something? So there's this thing in comics we talk about sometimes of, like, whatever was the thing you came in on, that's your favorite?
Oh, yeah.
Right? So do you ever feel like you've experienced that in the opposite, where you like were reading something for a long time, but your favorite was, because like Legion of Superheroes is the one people use as example a lot. Like, my favorite Legion of Superheroes is Zero Hour Legion of Superheroes.
Right.
And that's because that was my entry into it. Right. Like, sure. I was reading Legion of Superheroes before that. I was reading a little bit of 5 Year Later, and I was reading a little bit of Legionnaires right before. But then when Zero Hour hits, it's like, here's the beginning of this story. And I read that all the way through. Like, I read that all the way until they disappeared before the three boot stuff. And so it's like the Mark Waid stuff with Barry Kitson much, much later. But I read all of that all the way through. So that will always be, like, probably the most, like, my Legion of Superheroes.
Sure.
But I don't know what is the thing of, like, I'm curious if there's anything that's like that. I mean, I guess it would depend on the generation you're in. Like, if you were reading in the 60s, 70s. Go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, like, so I came in... My first comic that I read, mm-hmm. I was 3 years old. My dad, I told this before, my dad, he had a friend who was an Italian, like from Italy, Taylor. And he would go every Saturday morning and sit and talk with his friend and drink coffee. And so to keep me quiet, he would bring, let my mom sleep, he would bring me and my brother, buy us comics, and we would sit in this Taylor shop and read comics. So the first comic I remember getting was Justice League International number one, or just Justice League number one, the Kevin Maguire cover.
Yeah.
Classic thing, you know. And
I just read it last week again. It's so good.
It's fantastic. I just reread it recently too. But the first comic that I felt like was mine was the Kyle Rayner Green Lantern. Like, I came into that at, I was good. Like 10 or 11 when that happened, or, you know, whatever it was.
Yes. And just,
like, that was my thing.
And yeah, dude, you get, you know, Ron Mars and Daryl Banks. So good.
The only comic I have hanging on my wall in my house is a Kyle Rayner cover signed by both those guys. So that's...
Man, is it, like, you mean the original art? Are you talking about, like,
No, it's the actual comic. It's not the original art.
Oh, okay, the actual comic. What issue is it?
It's the first appearance of Kyle. It's the Hal with the rings.
Oh, yeah, so was that 48?
Yeah, 48, yeah.
Yeah, 48, yeah, dude. That's awesome. Yeah, Kyle, that's a great example. Yeah, Kyle's like, you feel an ownership over Kyle.
What I was going to say was, at first, I was like, well, fuck this Geoff Johns guy because he's getting rid of my Kyle. Like, he's bringing back Hal. I don't want Hal stories. I want Kyle stories, you know? And obviously, yeah. I came around on that a bit. But it's funny because we were talking about, you know, in the 90s, it was all about expanding the definition of what characters could be. Even Batman, with Azrael becoming Batman for a while, that was a big deal, you know? It was, and then I feel like for a while, the trend was to pull it back again. You didn't get rid of those characters. Kyle was still there, but it was clear that there was the Green Lantern and there were the other Green Lanterns, you know, or there was the Flash and there were the other Flashes. And I'm liking that we're starting to see more of a leveling out of that again.
Yeah, I think a lot of this is coming back. I mean, I can't really speak to, because I wasn't there. Like, I don't know why. I mean, I can tell you the meeting that I'm in, you know, and it's like me and the creators that I know, those are all our books too, you know? Right. Like, if I sit and talk to James or Steve, you can tell in the work we do, we obviously came up in that time period. You
right,
know?
Right.
I love that stuff. You know, it's like, if you look at the stuff that James does, we're always sneaking stuff in, you know? The fact that, you know, James got to have the Azbats armor in his detective run, you know? Like, he was able to bring that stuff in. Like, you can tell, you know, and obviously the fact that he works with, like, Anarchy, you know? And clearly, you know, James working with Tim Drake a lot in Detective. It's right. Like, clearly, and I know that's his favorite Robin, but it's like, you know, yeah, clearly, like, we love that stuff. And so we're always trying to find ways of bringing that stuff back or tying it in and try to, like, utilize that stuff because, you know, it is important to us, but it's something that brought us in. Like, I think about sidekicks all the time. Like, this is a big thing. Like, kind of what we're talking about is that DC had a resurgence of sidekicks in the early 90s, right? Because, you know, you had Bart and Tim and Connor and Cassie and, like, all of these new sidekicks kind of being brought into the equation. Now, I'm not sure if they were all introduced. Cause obviously Bart and Connor are 90s. Tim, I'm trying to remember what year Tim was actually introduced. I think it was 91, might be 90. Like they're all characters, you know, that we sort of were able to come in on because they were younger, newer characters. Like you're saying with Kyle, like you were able to see Kyle's origin. And so you were able to kind of, I think that is something that is important. I think about this a lot, like more lately, about having the ability to kind of introduce these worlds through a point of view character that has that, like, and sometimes it's as simple as that character saying what's going on. Because I had this thing recently, I want to get like really insider with you on this, but there was a moment recently where I was writing an issue with Justice League, and there were a Valley of Starros, just this whole thing where they come across, it's for Death Metal, and they come across this huge valley of like hundreds of Starros, and they have to cross this valley, and you know, Nightwing is there, and Nightwing is like, oh no, it's a lot of Starros. And then, like, Cyborg makes a comment, and then Hawkgirl is like, oh, I miss Jaro. And Cyborg is like, who's Jaro? And Hawkgirl is like, you were gone for a long time. Like, you know, there's all these little jokes, but in that moment, I never explain what a Starro is. I never explain what a Starro is. And I got a note of, like, should somehow you or one of the characters explain what Starro is? And I was like, no, because I didn't feel like it was organic in that moment, because all of these characters are there because it's like, it's Nightwing, Detective Chimp, Cyborg, Hawkgirl, and Starfire. All of them know what a Starro is. There's no reason for them to explain to the rest of them. Like, it would be ridiculous. You'd be like, by the way, I know you fought Starro a million times, but let me give you a history lesson on what a Starro is.
In case you forget. Like,
you know, in case you didn't know, even though I know you fought one, let me tell you who Starro is. So I didn't want to do, I went back and was like, hey, I don't think there's an organic way of doing this. We can kind of bits and piece this out later, right? You know, I don't have to have an info dump in this moment. also, you know, it's part two of a crossover to a giant event. It's like, how much am I going to explain in this? Yeah. You know, I don't want to bog it down explaining all this other stuff. So I think it's good to have those kinds of point of view entry characters, because if I had, for example, if I had had a new character in that scene, mm-hmm. there would be a reason to explain it to everybody.
Right.
And I think that is part of people's entry. And I think that's why the 90s, you know, that's why new characters are so important, you know, like I said, because if you get these new characters, you build them up and they introduce them. But think about Kyle, it's like everything was new to Kyle. And not only is everything new to Kyle, there was nobody there to explain it to him. Because yep. Gambit just like pops mm-hmm. out of town, you know, gives him the ring and is like, I'm out of here, I'll see you later. Like, Gantha doesn't hang around to be like, this is what a Green Lantern is. This is how it works. This is what happens here. It's like, he has to kind of, like, figure it out. And in that process of figuring it out, it allows you to kind of relate to him, I think, and sort of get brought into that world. Because as much as we know, it's interesting considering what the reader knows and doesn't know when you're writing some of these books. And you're putting these books together, because you're just like, you know, it is interesting, because it's like, if you were a fan of Green Lantern and you were like a hardcore fan, you've been reading it for like 20 years, and then you come into this Kyle book, and as we know, people were pissed when Al went crazy, but it's like, there probably is a certain level of resentment, or it's like, I know all of this, mm-hmm. but for somebody who is brand new and is younger coming into that character, it's an opportunity for them to get caught up to speed, and then they can share that love with you. And I think that's what Jeff did really well, was that, like you were saying, it's like, once you get around Green Lantern Rebirth, it was very clear that Jeff didn't want to dismiss Kyle, and he didn't want to dismiss what Kyle had gone through. What was interesting about bringing Hal back at that time was that he was actually able to make Hal the new POV character, because Hal had missed so much.
Right.
Right? So he became the new character to explain things to, because you could have people be like, oh, this person's dead, this person's dead. There's that scene at the beginning of Blackest Night, where it's Hal and Barry, and they're at the graveyard, and they're talking about everybody who's died. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting how you're able to like bring, using these older characters to bring people back up. But then here's another 90s book that was great, and it came out at the tail end of the 90s for DC, was JSA, which was, that was James Robinson, but, you know, Grant came into it.
Yeah.
That's a great example of a book where it's like they took all these characters that had been around for a while that maybe you weren't as familiar with, and were able to, like, introduce this whole world to people.
Yeah. I mean, I think that JSA book is a really masterful case of metering out information slowly and not necessarily dumping too much at once on everybody. And
yeah, for sure.
When you reread it, there's a ton of characters in that book, but you never feel overwhelmed by it, because it just does a nice job of just giving you little bits at a time.
Yeah, I think it's one of the best examples of a team book, because there are so many characters in it. And yeah, at no time do you ever feel like everyone is getting shorted. You know, like, everybody has kind of a scene or a moment, but, you know, when you go back and look at that, what's interesting about that book, in terms of, like, new readers, because it's a giant omnibus in my office.
You realize you can sell that for, like, $300, right?
This one?
I believe
that. Actually, what's that?
I believe that's the out-of-print one, yeah.
Yeah, these are the out-of-print ones. Yeah, I found that out. So there's this is, like, my insider thing I did. So I am on the comp list, and so now I'll get books, you know, for free from DC. I'm exclusive to them, so now I'll get a lot of stuff from them. But, you know, stuff like this back before then I wasn't able to get, and I didn't realize all this stuff went out of print. There's these, plus there's a bunch of other ones, like the first run of Jeff John Omnibus was for Flash. There's a few others that are out of print.
Starman on the buy. After like Starman number 3, I think those get really hard to find. The Starman.
Dude, and so I have all those right here. But it's like, so basically I found out there was a librarian who was in town here, who loves comic books. And he has this crazy huge collection of comics. And he was like, I'm running out of room, you know, I'm going to sell these off. And I found out he had all this stuff, and I was like, I will buy them. I will buy them. And then what I am doing was I took a lot of the comps that I was getting from DC. If there was anything that I already had or things I was like, maybe not interested as much, but, and you get doubles sometimes, and I just donated all of it to the library. But what I was going to say about JSA, I totally forgot there's this huge like JSA, like mini event before JSA got started.
Yep.
Is that when you read JSA, depending on when you start, but if you read, it's funny with JSA, like before issue one even came out, they had so many, like, there was like a weird little mini event that came out first. Mm-hmm. There was like one shot. I think the Super Files came out before issue one. They were really setting the stage for you to be like, by the time you read issue one, you're going to know who these characters are. Yep. But it's like, if you sit here and you read the beginning of this book, it's like Kid Eternity. It opens up with Kid Eternity, Sandman, a funeral. Like, it has all this stuff. And yeah, this is actually issue one. But it's interesting how many characters they introduced to JSA and how quickly they introduced. Oh, yeah. The secret files has this whole scene with Sandman at the beginning, right?
Yep. Where he kills himself.
He kills himself, yes, yeah. Because he knew it was coming and he wanted to like pass on the dreams and stuff. But that scene's crazy because it has like Sand and the Gray Man and like all these people, and you're like, who are all these people? I mean, I think like you and I, maybe we were just DC nerdy enough that we knew who they were. But
sure, no, but you're right. I mean, and this is the last thing that we're gonna talk about, because I got to let you go in a minute. But I think that one of the real tools for kids that were growing up around my age is that I was and am obsessed with Who's Who, and I loved having the Who's Who book because it let me feel like I could. I would read a comic, I didn't know who a character was, and most times I went to my Who's Who books, I could find out who that person was. And I feel like that was such a formative thing for me growing up, or reading those and not knowing a character, and then 6 months later you're reading a comic and you say, oh shit, that's that guy. That's that guy from Who's Who number four, whatever. I loved that experience.
Dude, it's interesting back then. I mean, now when that kind of stuff, you have Wikipedia and you have YouTube, like you can find out the history of an entire character on YouTube.
Right.
But with Who's Who, you know, they're introducing, they're bringing that back as an omnibus, right? You see that they're bringing those back. I actually have them here on my desk right now. I have the original run. It's like literally right here. But one thing for me with that was collectible cards.
Oh,
like, you open this pack of collectible cards, you open it up and it's like Marvel or DC, and I rip it open and it would be like, I know who like three of the characters were, and there'd always be like three more that I'm like, who is this person?
Why do I have an ultimate nullifier card? You know, like,
yeah, but it was interesting when you got characters, like it would be, you know, especially with cosmic stuff, because with Marvel, I was never that tied into the cosmic. I was always much more like, you know, X-Men and Spider-Man, and again, Hulk. Like, I was always more in that corner. I wasn't in the Avengers and the cosmic side of things as much when I was a kid.
You were a Quasar dude.
You were a Quasar dude?
No, you weren't a Quasar dude.
No. I read that book much later, but at the time, like, just wasn't in my, like, point of view or whatever. It wasn't something I was, like, really gravitating towards. But it would be crazy because I'd go through those packs of cards and then, yeah, there'd be a Quasar card. And you'd read the back and be like, man, this guy sounds cool. You know, or this is interesting. You know, you want to go and read it. That was actually when I really got introduced to the idea of the Golden Age, because DC released this one card set that would have like multiples and you could put them next to each other and it would be like modern, bronze, and golden, or you know what I mean? Like modern, silver, and gold. And that's when it was like, so it'd be like Cheetah, right? It'd be like three cards for Cheetah, and it would have this like the Golden Age Cheetah, and which is the one that has like the mask goes over her face and the ears and stuff. And it'd be like, oh, I had no idea. Like, so you'd look like Blue Beetle. Like, I didn't know who Blue Beetle was, but they would show the older Blue Beetle, Dan Garrett?
Yep.
Right? Yeah, the Dan Garrett Blue Beetle. And I'd be like, I had no idea there was this other Blue Beetle. And because of the collectible cards, I kind of miss collectible cards a little bit.
Me too.
I snuck a collectible cards thing into a comic that hasn't come out yet. but you'll see. You'll see when it comes out. I snuck like a gimmick in there about collectible cards as a way to introduce the characters. But I feel like I miss it. There was every time somebody, it kind of comes up a little bit, because even when Marvel did Executioner Song, they came polybag with the collectible cards for Executioner Song. I miss collectible cards a little bit. I kind of wish they would find a way to bring them back. I think people would be like, for nostalgia, but also for introducing people to some of this stuff. I know they are. Like, I think Marvel Masterpieces are coming back.
I think they might be, yeah. I mean, I know for me, you know, I have a big box, I have like a big, this big tin of cards. It's baseball cards and comic cards and all that in there. And my kids will sometimes just go through it and they do find characters. Like, who's this guy? What's this guy all about? You know, it's just a cool way to introduce people to things.
Yeah, my daughter's like that too. She'll grab books out of my office and she'll go through and she'll be like, who's this person? Who's this person? Who's this person? And you're like, oh, it's this, it's this, and this. And then she'll gravitate to whatever, right? So like right now, she's obsessed with Spider-Man. Okay. And yeah, she loves Spider-Man. So Spider-Verse, we finally watched Spider-Verse with her like 2 weeks ago. But a character that she's been really obsessed with lately, she saw a picture of Silk. And it's just been like, who is Silk? And I was like, oh, okay, well, I don't have that many Silk comics, but I can get you Silk comics. Like, you know, we can get you all kinds of Silk stuff if you're obsessed with Silk. But it is interesting how, you know, she has, because we got a bunch of other stuff like Spider-Gwen and whatever stuff. And like, it is interesting the characters that she kind of gravitates towards that she just kind of sees randomly in a book. But
my daughter got obsessed with Star Sapphires for that reason.
Oh, really?
Yeah. She was like, who are these people? Awesome. Purple Ring, I love it. And I was like, yeah, well, and so we've been going through all that stuff. So anyway, I have to let you go. Where can folks find you on the internet? They want to see more of your...
Just go to Twitter. That's where I usually post the most stuff. It's like, if you go to Williamson_Josh, that's where you get the most updates on what I'm doing and what's going on with my comics and stuff.
Yeah. And what's one comic that's coming out now? You can't say one of your own that people should be reading.
Department of Truth, even though I think everyone's going to be reading it already, but you should definitely pick up James Tynion and Martin Simon's Department of Truth.
Nice.
Comes out in a few weeks. Last week of September? No, first week of October, I think.
Okay. Yeah.
Somewhere in there. Might be last week of the month. Might be last week of September.
Time is meaningless at this point. Who knows?
I know. Yeah. You know, yeah. So.
All right, Josh, my friend, always a pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Let's do this, not talk about comics one of these days.
Yeah, for sure. Well, someday we'll actually get to a convention again. Someday.
Let's hope so.
Yeah. All right. Bye. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, take care, man. Bye-bye.